We have always been a little obsessed with tales of civilizations swallowed by the sea. Atlantis. The legend of Lemuria, home to an ancient Tamil civilization. And Kevin Costner seeking the last dry land, the Himalayas. Today, these stories might not be as far from reality as we think. Ocean levels are rising, faster than ever before. And cities everywhere are preparing for it by raising seawalls, elevating homes, and even reclaiming land from the ocean. Will it work? Can we come to terms with sea level rise? If you live somewhere up in the mountains, you're probably good. But 1 billion people live within 10 kilometers from the coast today. That includes many of the world's largest financial hubs. We're talking Mumbai, New York, Shanghai, Jakarta. And the sea is creeping up on us. We've had more than 20 centimeters of rise since 1880. But it's accelerating. How much? Depends on our emissions. By now, sea levels are rising about 3 to 4 millimeters every year. That doesn't seem like much, but over a lifetime, that's a lot of water. By the end of the century, they could be roughly 1 meter higher compared to levels from 1900, or even more.
The numbers that I hear that I think are more realistic, and again, a lot depends on our emission rates, is 2 to 3 meters by 2100.
Sharon Gray is a marine scientist at the Rising Seas Institute in Florida. There are two main factors driving sea level rise. And guess who's behind both? It's us humans, of course. First up, melting ice. You may know this graph. Mean temperatures have risen by roughly 1.5 degrees compared to pre-industrial levels. Due to global warming, ice sheets and glaciers, especially in the great ice masses of Greenland and Antarctica, are disappearing. There's a lot of water stored in ice, enough to push sea levels up. Second, there's thermal expansion. That's just a fancy term to say that water expands as it warms. Just like the liquid in this thermometer. Oceans are doing just that, and it's sort of baked in for the next centuries. Even if we shut down all gas and oil plants today, the CO2 in the air will keep warming oceans for generations. That's because oceans absorb the heat trapped in the atmosphere by carbon dioxide. 90% of it, in fact. But it's not the same everywhere. Look at this map. Ocean currents and gravity shift water around, making it rise higher in those red areas and lower in the blue. As the water rises, so do the problems. It threatens vital coastal infrastructure, such as ports and power plants. Storm surges and coastal flooding and erosion intensify with sea level rise. Saltwater is already ruining farmland and contaminating drinking water. So, what options do we have? Perhaps the most obvious on the solutions list, protection. Let's just build a wall using waterproof material. Dikes, levees, embankments do the same job. We've relied on them for countless generations to hold back the sea. Like here, on Germany's northern coast. There's a high risk of flooding and storm tides because this region is low-lying. So every 10 years, local authorities calculate how high the dikes should be, based on the prognosed sea level 100 years from now. This one needs about a meter more.
See, unten, das ist der alte Deich. Und das da oben, das ist der neue Deich. Und das ist halt ein Riesenunterschied. Ich versink da fast drin.
You can spot seawalls and embankments pretty much everywhere on Earth. They need a little space, but they're expensive. 4.6 million euros for renovating just 750 meters of this dike. Poorer regions often can't afford it, and there are risks that come with sealing off a certain area.
What if there's a failure, then, and an area floods, then you get what we call the bathtub effect, which means, you know, the water is stuck in the city and cannot flow out.
As a Dutch architect in New York, Stefan L. designed sustainable and resilient buildings. Walls only make sense if the water doesn't find another way. And they simply don't work in some parts of the world. Along the Indian coastline, there's a fishing village on average every 2 kilometers.
The people inhabiting those villages depend entirely on the beach.
Orofilio Schiavina grew up in Pondicherry. He studied the Indian coastline with his NGO Pondicherry.
So let's say the moment you replace the beach with another structure, for example, a seawall, you have actually excluded, you know, you have isolated those people from the ocean. They are unable to use the beach space. They lose their livelihoods.
But there are other ways to protect coastlines from flooding. Salt marshes, mangrove forests, and wetlands are all natural soft barriers. Here, in Adarampattinam at the southern tip of India, mangroves are being planted to buffer flooding. Their intricate roots stabilize beaches and help prevent coastal erosion. According to one report, they can even trap up to 80% of the sediment that's washed up and cause beaches to grow, but only if they are planted in spaces without strong tides. And there is another bonus. They can migrate inland as the sea level rises and keep being a buffer. But large strips have been cut down.
There's a lot of pressure, you know, on the coastline. Land is valuable and the value of the land is only increasing. And that according to me, is the primary reason why mangroves are under threat.
Nature often comes second. So what else can we do? Why not learn to live with the water? Look at this map of New York. Large swathes of the city are under threat from flooding. In 2012, Hurricane Sandy caused over $60 billion in damage and made future floods feel real. The city has had to bring in new construction standards for structures in flood risk areas. It includes ensuring buildings are either elevated to a safe degree or sealed on lower levels to prevent water coming in. Some building projects even add an extra margin.
The higher you do it, the more expensive it is. But in New York, they take on average about 6 feet or 2 meters.
In other regions, locals are learning to rise with the tide. Timbuluko is a village on Indonesia's island Java. On top of rising seas, the land itself is subsiding. So residents have kept raising their houses with stilts. But now, they can't go any higher. Almost 500 kilometers away in Muara Angke in Jakarta, these houses sit on stilts made from steel. They have just been built with a view to making them more durable to the salty seawater. Other solutions, these floating foundations keep some 100 Dutch residents of Schoonship high and dry. And entire floating cities are being dreamed up. Take Oceanics Busan, a glossy UN-backed plan for a district in Busan Harbor. It looks great on CGI, but years after its big reveal, there's little sign of construction. These projects face major hurdles, securing reliable power and water, managing waste, and withstanding storm surges. For now, this is still more thought experiment than reality. Accommodation measures can be effective for our current predicament, and it can buy time to prepare for future scenarios. But they're not long-term solutions. So if the sea is eating up our land, why not just create new, higher land? Here, among the waves of the Indian Ocean in the Maldives, a whole new island is being dug up. Over 11 square kilometers of land. It is set to provide space for 65,000 homes. The Atoll Nation is no stranger to dredging. To prevent overcrowding in the capital Malé, they expanded the city onto neighboring artificial islands. This is being done on a massive scale. One study suggests an area roughly the size of Luxembourg has been dredged over the last 25 years. But much of that is to create more real estate. Another state dredging land is Tuvalu, a low-lying island state in the Pacific. They have no higher land to retreat to, so they're building some. That will hopefully be safe from sea level rise until 2100. But they're also pursuing another option, one that few people want to think about. Retreat. On November 9th, 2023, Tuvalu signed a migration pact with Australia. Each year, 280 Tuvaluans will get permanent residency here. According to the World Meteorological Organization, sea levels in parts of the Pacific have risen almost twice the global rate since 1993. Without action, almost this entire island could be routinely flooded by the end of the century. That's why they just scanned every corner to build a 3D map, so Tuvalu can persist in digital form, even if the land disappears. Retreating is the most drastic solution, and perhaps the most complex, because we have no idea of the social, cultural, and financial implications.
Something that I like to point out to people who are, you know, I'm far from the ocean, not going to affect me. Well, a whole lot of the population lives on the coast. And when you talk about people having to, you know, kind of abandon those areas, where are they going to go? You know, they're going to be moving inland. It's going to be an issue for everybody.
There's one thing most of these adaptation measures have in common.
Actually, it's almost always a reaction to a disaster. And sometimes they say you need two disasters for it to happen.
The thing is, with sea level rise, for many decision makers, it's sort of a future you problem.
2100 is still a long time ahead. It's probably not within my lifetime, unfortunately. but that makes it a little bit difficult to plan for it, because very often, you know, politicians are in place for 5 years. Do they really care about, you know, 2 centimeters of sea level rise during their reign? Maybe not, right?
It's easier for people to say sea level rise is too far off to worry about or too inevitable to stop. But neither of those excuses will let us off the hook. Smart adaptation needs to take a long-term perspective, ditch the one-size-fits-all mindset, and be tailor-made to the place it's protecting. Of course, this smart thinking would need one thing. Us ending fossil fuels, the chief engine of global warming. Because we don't want our grandchildren to end up like Kevin Costner, right?
Is sea level rise a concern where you live? Let us know in the comments. Subscribe for more videos like this and check out dw.com for more stories.